We have looked at two of the three major ideas in the numerical solution strategy. So you looked at discretization, that is, you find the displacements and rotations only at selected points rather than everywhere. We've also looked at interpolation. So discretization and interpolation are two of the major ideas we have looked at. The third major idea is derivation of algebraic equations. Let's take a look at that. And, you know, and we're looking at a very simplified scenario here compared to the wind turbine blade case, but understanding this will help us understand what we do in answers for the wind turbine blade case. And we need to find, so we've reduced the problem to finding 654 degrees of freedom. And I can find these either, you know, first I can use boundary conditions, and let's say I have simple boundary conditions. I'll say this is, you know, this whole boundary is fixed, which means that all degrees of freedom at that boundary are set to zero. Well, I'm sorry about that. So you have 6 plus 6 plus 6, 18 degrees of freedom, of which 9 are displacements and 9 are rotations. So I would say 18, in this particular simplified scenario, 18 degrees of freedom can be determined from boundary condition, particularly the displacement constraint. You'd say essential boundary condition. Okay, which means we are left with 54 minus 18, 36 degrees of freedom. And these 36 degrees of freedom, you determine such that the potential energy of the structure is minimized. So from our 54 degrees of freedom, okay, by interpolation, we can construct the displacement anywhere in the structure, right? So if I have a normal like that and a point over here, once I know the degrees of freedom, I can reconstruct, you know, how much that, where that that particular point would move. So I'd find the displacement in the structure, and once I know the displacement field, I can differentiate it to find the strains, the strain components, 6 strain components. And once I know the strains, I can use the material properties to find the stresses. And once I know the strains and the stresses, as discussed in the cantilever beam module, you can find the potential energy, okay? Which means that we really have a very complicated function that relates these degrees of freedom to the potential energy. And we want to find these degrees, and we want to find the 36 of these such that this is minimized. So for instance, let's take a look at that particular degree of freedom, that is how much this node is going to move normal to the surface. And if I look at the variation of the potential energy versus that particular degree of freedom, if I hold everything else the same, okay, the potential energy variation is going to be something like that. And we don't know what that variation is, but we're really interested only in that point, because that's going to be where the potential energy is minimum and where the, you know, the structure is going to be in equilibrium. So that you can find by setting the potential energy versus, you know, you can take the derivative with respect to uz2 equal to 0, and that will give us an algebraic equation, okay, relating, and that algebraic equation relate the degrees of freedom at neighboring nodes. Similarly, you know, for all the other 36 unknown degrees of freedom, you know, or all the other 35 unknown degrees of freedom, you can generate algebraic equations. So ANSYS has automated procedures to generate these algebraic equations. So it'll generate a total of 36 algebraic equations in this particular case. You'll have a lot more in the wind turbine blade case. And once you invert that, you can find your degrees of freedom, okay, 36 plus 18, 54, and then you know everything else. And that's, you know, you can calculate everything else from post-processing. For instance, once I know those degrees of freedom, I can calculate the deformed shape of the mid-surface. So that's the procedure by which the numerical solution strategy works. Now, the boundary condition in the Winterwine blade case is more complicated than just a fixed boundary condition. You use something called a remote boundary condition, in which case, you know, you're and we're essentially allowing the root of the blade to kind of rotate in a particular way. And you can think of this as, you know, a more complex version of the fixed boundary condition.